Good day, everybody, or good evening for many of us. It is my great honor and really pleasure to introduce an old friend and collaborator on previous many missions, Professor Jørgen Christensen-Dalsgaard from Aarhus University in Denmark, who today is giving our CFA colloquium, literally 6 minutes after the successful landing of the Mars 2020 lab and the Perseverance rover. It seems that everything went perfectly. So now let's do something fun and hear from Jørgen about his work on stars and the sun. Jørgen got his PhD in 1978 from University of Cambridge, working on theoretical topics of helioseismology with one of the premier theorists of the seismology of the sun, Douglas Goff in Cambridge. And he turned what was at the time the new frontier of studying the sun, and particularly the interior of the sun, into another new frontier of studying the interiors, and particularly the makeup and ages of stars, or the field of astroseismology, predicting stellar oscillations in a 1983 paper. And in a sense, starting the field of astroseismology, which, however, he published in a journal called Solar Physics. So I'm afraid at the time, many of the stellar astronomers didn't read it carefully. But eventually, and now this is a way to rewrite and reimagine stellar physics and stellar evolution. And a lot of it has come thanks to the theoretical work done by Jørgen and co-author, collaborators, but also by the amazing amount of data which came to the field via the astronomy's new interest in exoplanets. So Jørgen became and was a major member of the Kepler team and led the Kepler Astroseismic Science Consortium, which was many times bigger than the Kepler team itself, international, and combined the effort of essentially the entire stellar astrophysics community in something which we are looking forward to hear from Jørgen is really a new era and revolution in understanding stars. So Jørgen, please take it from here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much again.
Thank you, and on this very happy afternoon or evening. So I'm very happy to give this talk. Of course, I regret not being in what you call Cambridge. We can always debate about that. I have been, of course, several times to CFA, and I enjoyed it very much, enjoyed my collaboration with people there. So what I want to talk about is results from the Kepler mission, and specifically what I think is the most exciting stellar astrophysics coming out of Kepler, namely the study of red giants. But let me start just with the basics of stellar structure. We have the stellar core with the nuclear reactions, the energy generation there, the radiation zone, and then we have the outer convection zone, and then all the stuff happening on the surface of the star. This is a main sequence star like the sun. But if we look at the evolution of stars, then this is a very schematic sketch of the sun with an hydrogen fusion in the core, the outer layers. And then when hydrogen is used up at the center of the star, we are left with a star with a helium core surrounded by a shell where there's still hydrogen fusion. And then even later in the evolution, the temperature in the helium core becomes so high that helium fusion starts, helium fusing to carbon and oxygen. We still have the rest of the helium core. And then we have the hydrogen burning shell around that helium core. So those are the very basic structures that we're going to look at. And of course, in particular, these red giants, and they are giants. If you look at the stars in the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, we have the main sequence star down here. And then as a star evolves through this hydrogen burning shell phase, its radius and luminosity increases up to, for one solar mass star, a few times, about 2,000 times the solar luminosity. Then helium ignites, the luminosity falls, stars behave always the opposite way from what you expect. And then we have a star in what we call the red clump phase, where we have a helium burning core, then the helium core and the hydrogen burning shell around it. And so these are basically the evolution stages we are going to look at. And observationally, for stars with masses of 1-2 solar masses, it's actually almost impossible to tell the difference between these two phases, because this helium burning phase lies very close to the red giant branch. You can see that there are more stars here because this phase lasts quite a while. So there's an enhancement of the number of stars in this region, but not much possibility of telling them apart. And that, of course, is one of the things that we're going to get back to. But the main point here really is that all this nice picture, of course, is modeling. Well, we can continue and make models also of how the stars look like a simulation of the Mars landing. Main sequence stars growing into red giants, becoming what we call asymptotic red giants, and then losing the outer layers and become white dwarfs and planetary nebula. So this is all a very good story, but of course the question is it right? Is it true? And the difficulty here is that we can see what the stars look like on the surface, and it sort of looks all right. I mean, we can identify these different phases of evolution. But it's very hard to look into a star and see whether these processes we discuss are actually going on. What we observe on stars are, we observe the effects of temperature, we observe the composition with some uncertainty. For some stars, we can measure the radius directly, assuming we know how far away the stars are. We have a measure of the surface gravity. We might have a measure of the luminosity of the star. In some few cases, we can get the mass of the star, but all this doesn't say anything directly about what happens inside the star, what the internal properties are like. And that, of course, is what we need to test these models and test our understanding of the evolution of stars. And so that was the question raised, and it's scary that this is almost 100 years ago now, by Sir Arthur Eddington, in his book, The Internal Constitution of the Stars. And his point was that the deep interior of sun stars is less accessible to scientific investigation than any other region of the universe, simply because we lack an appliance to test the conditions within the star. For Eddington, that appliance was theory, and of course he developed that to a very fine art. But now we do have that appliance that Eddington was looking for, namely astroseismology. The fact that we can use observations of stellar oscillations to study the stellar interiors. And that is, as Dimitar introduced the talk with, that's what I've been working on since I was a PhD student and keep doing here just before my retirement in a couple of years. And I certainly plan to go on after retiring, working on this. That's too much fun in doing this. So the point about observing stellar oscillations is that you can get oscillation frequencies with very, very high precision. In the solar case, we know the frequencies much better than we know the mass of the sun, because the dissemination of the mass depends on the dissemination of gravitational constants. But the frequencies are sensitive to the internal structure of all the star, also to the way it rotates, and other aspects of stars we'll see. And then, and I'm not going to talk about that today, but we can also study the mode amplitudes and learn about near surface physics, the physics of the excitation of the modes. So that's the tool that we're going to use to study the red giants. To see how we can do that, we need to understand a bit more about the properties of these oscillations. And there's sort of three aspects of that that we need to look at. We need to look at the geometry of the oscillations, the dynamics, and how they are excited. The geometry of small amplitude oscillations of a spherical body, or almost spherical body, is described by spherical harmonics. So just showing a few here, characterized by the degree L of the mode and the azimuthal order M. And L counts the number of nodal lines on the surface of the star, and M counts the number of nodal lines crossing the equator. And actually what we're looking at in distant stars are just the low degree modes. For these higher degree modes, the averaging over the stellar surface kills the signal. So what we're looking for are these modes with degree zero. I haven't plotted that here, 1, 2, maybe 3. So that's geometry. Then dynamics, that is a question of the forces that create the restoring of the oscillations, the restoring forces. And here we have two different classes of modes. We have acoustic modes, just standing sound waves. We are very familiar with that. They tend to have high frequency. They depend obviously mainly on the sound speed inside the star. Sound speed depends on temperature and composition, so that's the kind of information we get. And the low degree modes, low degree acoustic modes extend all the way to the center of the star. It's sometimes claimed that we, you see, looking at acoustic modes, we only learn about the outer layers of the star, but actually we get information even going quite deep into the core of the sun, for instance. The second class of modes are standing internal gravity waves. And in main sequence stars, at least they have low frequency, but in evolved stars, they have frequencies in the same range as the acoustic modes. And that is something we're going to discuss in detail later. And they depend on what's called a buoyancy frequency, which is sort of the frequency of a blob oscillating up and down in gravity, in the gravitational field. And that also depends strongly on the composition profile inside the star. And so we get a different kind of information from what we get from the acoustic modes. Now, these internal gravity waves are not so familiar as the acoustic waves, but we see them actually quite frequently in the Earth's atmosphere. So here's an example from outside Copenhagen, where what we see here is actually the effect of a gravity wave in the Earth's atmosphere causing the location where the clouds condense to vary in altitude, so we get this wave-like pattern. And that's something you see quite often in the atmosphere and also in the oceans. In any place where you have a gradient in density, you might get these kinds of waves. And we see them in stars. So that's the dynamics, but of course we have to excite the modes also, and here there are two different ways of doing it. The classical pulsating stars operates through a heat engine mechanism. It's often called the Kappa mechanism because it's driven by opacity, but other heat engines can work also. So that's one class of modes, but what we're actually into here is looking at modes that are intrinsically stable. So it means that if they're left alone, they die out, but they're forced by, and in the most we're looking at, acoustic noise from the near surface convection. We have this convection zone in the outer layers of these stars with gas motion that's close to sonic or even supersonic. And that's a very strong source of acoustic noise. And that noise encouples to the standing waves, the resonant modes of a star, and drives those modes to observable amplitudes. And that is what we see in the sun and in these solar-like stars. And then we have to observe them. And the observational techniques that we're using are rate of velocity. That was the way that solar oscillations were discovered. In main sequence stars, the amplitudes of the modes are then below 1 meter per second. And we can observe in distant stars degrees from 0 to 3. But of course, this requires higher resolution spectroscopy. So typically, I mean, resolution of the order of 100,000, because we want to get to this very low velocity amplitude. And so here we observe one star at a time. The other option is to observe the modes in intensity. And here we have to deal with amplitudes of oscillation of a few parts per million. And so something that's totally impossible to see from the ground, given the fluctuations of the Earth's atmosphere. Here we lose sensitivity to a large extent to modes of degree 3. But the real big advantage is that we can take pictures of stellar fields. And so we can observe very many stars at once. And these are actually the observations that we're going to use for the studies of the red giants. So we have to observe them with this very high sensitivity. We need very long observations because we want to go to very high frequency precisions. And here we are talking weeks, certainly months, absolutely, or ideally years. And especially for the red giants, which have quite long periods, we need to observe them for a really long time. And this is required to get the frequency precision that we need to study the details of stellar interiors. And we don't want gaps in the data, because gaps in the data introduce complications in the observed spectra. So to do that, you can either build a network of telescopes, and we're trying to do that. But of course, the ideal way to do it is really to go to space and find an orbit where we can observe a given field of stars continuously. So we need to find somebody willing to buy us a satellite and a telescope in space. And of course, many of us would have thought that doing that just to observe stellar oscillations would be very good motivation to produce a mission like that. And we tried very hard for many years to get a mission like that. But actually what turned out to save this field was the search for extrasolar planets. And the technique to look for planets by observing transits of planets in front of stars. Because the observational requirement for that kind of observation to see the Earth transiting the sun is that we can get a photometric precision of a few parts per million. And so a mission able to do that can also look for the stellar oscillations. And so we got this mission Kepler, and this turned out to be the perfect tool both for finding exoplanets and for doing astroseismology. So the main goal for Kepler was to observe, find exoplanets using the transit methods. Doing that by observing one field of stars for 100 square degrees in the northern sky in the constellations of Cygnus and Lyra, continuously for 4 years. Observing about 150,000 stars, in most cases observing with a 30-minute cadence and then observing 500 stars with a 1-minute cadence. For the red giants, a 30-minute cadence is fine. We have periods of many hours, days. For main sequence stars, we have to rely on these observations with the 1-minute cadence. And so Kepler was built in close to Boulder, Colorado. I actually went and saw it in the workshop. That was pretty fascinating. It's a 1 meter Schmidt telescope with a huge CCD detector in the middle. And the orientation is controlled by reaction wheels. And as Kipling would say, don't forget the reaction wheels. You would know the so-so stories by Kipling. The launch was on the 7th of March 2009, more than 10 years ago. And the guaranteed period was 4 years. And after 4 years, the last two reaction wheels failed. And then the nominal observational period stopped in May 2013. So those 4 years of data are the data that I'm actually going to use here. Kepler continued for another 4 years in a different observing mode, producing lots of good data, but with shorter time series. So where are we working in astroseismology? We're working everywhere. We find pulsating stars in all parts of the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. On the main sequence, solar-like main sequence stars, hotter main sequence stars, Cepheids, white dwarfs. But what we are talking about here are solar-like stars where the most are excited by this turbulent convection mechanism. And of course, the model for solar-like oscillating stars is the Sun. And so here we go back to time, a time just after I finished my PhD, with the first really detailed observations of the Sun, oscillations in the Sun, obtained from the South Pole by Greg et al. And showing this spectrum of quite a lot of very sharply defined modes of oscillation. So what's plotted here is the oscillation power, in this case, from radial velocity observations. And so each peak corresponds to a mode of oscillation of the Sun. And so what we see here is, I don't know, 40, 50 individual oscillation frequencies determined very precisely with a maximum amplitude around a frequency of 3 millihertz, a period of around 5 minutes. And so that's what we are looking for a long time in distant stars. And with Kepler, we get data of a quality that's even a lot better than what we had from the South Pole for the Sun. So this is a couple of main sequence solar-like stars, actually stars with masses quite close to the Sun, with the same oscillation spectrum as we saw in the Sun, again, very, very sharply defined frequencies. This is a binary system. And we can see that this one has slightly higher frequencies because it's a slightly smaller star. And this has slightly lower frequencies, a slightly bigger star. Both are slightly bigger than the Sun, where the maximum in amplitude was around 3 millihertz. And here we can see very clearly, let's just skip that. I think we have said that already. What we see in these stars in the Sun and Sun-like stars are high-order acoustic modes. And their frequency dependence on the mode order N and the degree L is basically just like an organ pipe, except that this is a spherical organ pipe. The frequencies are proportional to the mode order. There's a correction for the sphericity coming from the degree. And the separation between adjacent orders is just the sound travel time across the diameter of the star, the inverse of the integral of dr over c, where c is the sound speed. Then there's a small correction to that, lowest order asymptotics. And then there's a phase function depending on the reflection of the wave at the surface. And so what we immediately see when we observe a star is last frequency separation, the separation between adjacent mode orders. We can also measure the frequency of maximum power. And there it's been found observationally, we don't quite understand why, that this frequency is given by the surface gravity of the star, mass divided by the radius squared, with a small sensitivity to the effective temperature. So just by observing the amplitude distribution, we get a measure of the surface gravity. And we also measure this frequency separation, and you can show again, and that we do understand, that the frequency separation scales like the square root of the mean density of the star. And so already from these very simple observations, we get two measures of the mass and the radius, with slightly different radius dependence. And so from these, we can determine the mass and the radius of the star. And we can do that for tens and thousands of stars. And that in itself is a very interesting field, but that's not what I'm going to talk about. Because there's more to the data. If we look carefully at this frequency spectrum, we see that there's a fine structure. We have this large frequency separation here between two dipolar modes in between. And we can actually see that because of this LO2, that midways between the two radial modes, we'll have a mode with degree one. Midways between these two modes with degree one, we have a mode with degree zero. And very close to that, we have a mode where the order is lower by one and the degree is higher by two. So this bracket is the same. And so what we see is the effect of this small correction, a small frequency separation. And actually we see the same for L equal to one and three, zero and two, one and maybe three, zero and two. And so that's the structure of the frequency spectrum that we see in these solar-like oscillators. And we actually turns out that this frequency, small frequency separation is a measure of stellar age. So already here we have a way to determine the ages of a main sequence stars. But we want to talk about red giants. And a very important observation actually made by a different satellite, the French European core satellites, showed that red giants have the same kind of frequency structure as we see in the sun and the main solar, like main sequence stars. We have an envelope of peaks of modes here. And as we move to red giants with bigger and bigger radii, we see the same kind of frequency structure, but at lower and lower frequency. So as the stars grow bigger, the mean density grows smaller, and therefore the frequencies get lower. But the interesting thing is that we see the same behavior in stars where this frequency of maximum power is 20 microhertz, as we see in the sun where the frequency of maximum power is 3000 microhertz. It's the same physics, it's just shifted because the stars are bigger. And as I said, we can observe this in tens of thousands of stars. So this is a summary of observations of solar-like oscillations with Kepler in red and also core in blue. And what we see is this huge set of stars. Where we see the solar-like oscillations and plotted here in what looks like a Hesperon-Russell diagram. And it is basically the same, except that we're plotting the frequency of maximum power, on the ordinate axis. But since that is determined by the inverse square of the radius, that essentially corresponds to the luminosity. And so we have basically the Hesperon-Russell diagram here. And here we see this enhanced number of stars in this red clump region where we have the helium burning stars very close to the red giant branch. So that's all very good, but of course, just determining the mass and radius of stars doesn't really teach us very much about what goes on inside the stars. And that's where what I think is perhaps one of the most important papers in stellar astrophysics in recent time And actually just a one page research note in Science written by a PhD student in Leuven, Paul Beck, which showed that there's much more to these solar-like oscillations in red giants than you notice immediately. And the way to see that is to look at the oscillation spectrum. Now, here we have the main sequence star, one of the stars I showed earlier. We have the same spectrum, we have the spectrum I described before. We have the radial modes, the ellipse to zero modes, ellipse to two close by, ellipse one between in the midway between the two ellipse to zero modes, ellipse to two close by, and so on. And what Paul Beck found was that if you looked at a red giant instead, you see the same kind of pattern. The ellipse to zero modes here and here and here. You have ellipse to two modes close to the ellipse to zero modes here and here and here. And then you would expect to have one mode in between the ellipse one mode. But what you actually see is a cluster of modes. So there's something different about these red giants from what we see in Sun and other main sequence stars. And to understand that, we have to look in a bit more detail at the physics of the oscillations and get back to these internal gravity waves. And the way we can characterize the oscillations quite simply actually is in terms of two characteristic frequencies. One is a characteristic acoustic frequency. We have a sound wave, we have basically a squared wave number. And so this is really just a standard dispersion relation for sound waves, that the frequency is equal to the square of the wave, frequency squared is the square of the wave number times the sound speed squared. The second characteristic frequency is the buoyancy frequency, also called the Brunswick-Wassler frequency, and that is the frequency of a blob moving up and down in the gravitational field of the star is given by the difference between the adiabatic pressure gradient, the density gradient, and the actual density gradient. You can also write in terms of the temperature gradients in the way that we normally discuss convection. And actually from your stellar evolution course, you would remember that if this thing is negative, you get convective instability, you get blobs that accelerate exponentially, and so you get convection mixing. But here we are talking about cases, parts of the star where this is positive, and then you get an oscillation around the equilibrium instead, and that actually is what drives these modes that correspond to internal gravity waves. And what we can try, what you find if you analyze the behavior of the oscillations is that an oscillation would behave like an acoustic wave if it has a frequency exceeding both these characteristic frequencies. And it behaves like an standing internal gravity wave if the frequency is below both these two frequencies. And now what's interesting in the red giants is that we have this compact helium core, both on the red giant branch and in the clump. And if you look at how the star evolves and how different layers in the star changes with age, here I'm just taking a part of the red, starting basically from the bottom of the red giant branch and then following the evolution up the red giant branch. And this is the surface radius of the star in units of the solar radius. So we start out with a radius of slightly less than 2 solar radii. And then as the star evolves up the radian branch, the radius increases to almost 100 times the solar radius. But if we follow a layer that contains 15%, say, of the mass of the star, then that starts out corresponding to a radius of a tenth of solar radius. And then as the star evolves, this core contracts. And so we end up with a core that's only slightly more than 1% of the solar radius. So the outer layers of the star expand and the core of the star contracts. And that means that what we have here is a very compact core of only 1% of a solar radius containing 15% of the solar mass. And if we look at the central density, correspondingly, of course, the central density of a star increases dramatically from 1,000 grams per cubic centimeter up to almost 1,000,000 grams per cubic centimeter. But also because we have this very compact core containing quite a lot of mass, the gravitational acceleration on the surface of that core increases dramatically. And that means that this buoyancy frequency that depends on the gravitational acceleration increases dramatically. So if we plot these characteristic frequencies in a red giant, we have a huge buoyancy frequency in the inner part of the star, and this is a logarithmic scale, so we have 10% of the radius here. And then outside that, we have a huge convection zone extending over the outer 90% of the star, where the buoyancy frequency is zero. And so we have, and the acoustic frequencies become quite low. And so we have a region out here where the mode behaves like an acoustic wave. And we have a region in here where a given mode depends like a standing internal gravity wave. We have what we call a mixed mode with a mixed character, acoustic in the outer parts of the star and gravity wave-like in the inner part of the star. And so you can illustrate that. Actually, I thought we could illustrate that, but it seems I skipped that slide. So never mind, let's just move on. And look more carefully at how to characterize these modes. So we have a very dense spectrum of these internal gravity waves. What is plotted here is a measure of the energy or the inertia of the wave, an integral of the displacement squared times density. You could think velocity here instead, then this would be the kinetic energy of the wave, normalized by the displacement at the surface times the stellar mass. And again, you can see velocity here, and then you'd have a surface velocity. So this says something about how the displacement, the mode energy, is distributed through the star. And so if we have a mode that's confined to this internal region, the gravity wave region, then it would have a very high energy. Now, looking at the radial modes, the circles here, they are all acoustic, and they have quite low inertia. If we then look at the dipolar modes, the L2-1 modes, most of them have quite high inertia compared with the radial modes. And then there are cases where the inertia dips, and we get these low inertia close to the radial modes. And the same story for the quadrupolar modes, the L2-2 modes, in most cases quite high inertia, and then dips where the inertia comes down to almost a radial mode inertia. And if we blow up that, we can see that more clearly. And what's happening here is actually that we have acoustic resonances where the frequency of the mode resonates with the characteristic frequency of this outer acoustic region. And that means that the mode behaves predominantly as an acoustic mode with a small tail behaving like with gravity wave behavior in the interior. And even more so for the L2-2 modes. And we see that these dipolar resonances are halfway between the radial modes, as we saw for solar oscillations. And the quadrupolar, the L2-2 resonances, are very close to the radial modes, again, like we saw for the main sequence stars. But also we see that there's a group of modes here with fairly low inertia, fairly close to the radial mode inertias. And so we might expect to be able to observe a few modes in the vicinity of this acoustic resonance, at least for the dipolar modes. And to characterize these gravity waves, the purely internal standing gravity waves, they also have an asymptotic relation. Their periods are linear functions of their mode order. And there's a characteristic period spacing determined by an integral of the buoyancy frequency. And now we can go back to the observations and see that what we have here is actually this group of dipolar modes that have lower inertia and therefore are excited to observable amplitudes. We don't see that so much for the quadrupolar modes, for the helical two modes, because except for the mode that's very close to the acoustic resonance, the inertia is too large for a mode to be excited. And to demonstrate, and that was really the brilliance insight that Paul Beck had, to demonstrate that, he looked at period spacings between these adjacent modes in the vicinity of the acoustic resonance to show that this has this kind of V shape, and compared that with a model period spacing where we see a range of modes that are predominantly like standing gravity waves, but in the vicinity of the acoustic resonance, we have basically an extra mode, and therefore the period spacing dips in exactly the way we see for the observed period spacings. And so this was a demonstration that we are seeing the effect of the internal gravity waves in this star for dipolar modes. Now, this was really the slide I was looking for before, and just to demonstrate how we might illustrate what we see in these stars. Oscillations that have one kind of behavior in the outer parts of the star and a different behavior in the core of the star. And so this now gives us a chance to learn about the internal properties of these stars. So a consequence of that was found very quickly by Tim Betting and his group in Sydney. And that was that we can now actually tell the difference between the hydrogen and helium burning red giant stars. And to demonstrate that, Tim looked at two different stars observed by Kepler. Again, looked at the power spectra of the oscillations. And what we see here, and you must by now be pretty bored of these power spectra, they all look more or less the same. We have an amplitude envelope. We see this asymptotic structure of radial modes and dipolar modes and quadrupolar modes close to the radial modes. And we do actually see this cluster of dipolar modes here and here and here. And here we just see the radial and quadrupolar modes. And that's what we see in this star, and that's what we see in this star. But what Tim noticed was that the spacing of the peaks in these clusters is smaller in this star, and he measured an average spacing of 53 seconds than in this star, where the average spacing was 96 seconds. Otherwise, the stars look very similar. The separation between the radial modes, the last frequency separation, is more or less the same. But this period spacing is different. And what Tim realized was that this reflects the fact that this star has just hydrogen burning in the shell around an inert helium core. And this star, in addition, has helium burning in the helium core. And we can actually understand that difference between the two cases by looking again at this period spacing and look again at the characteristic frequencies. The acoustic characteristic frequencies shown in red are very similar. The bulk structure of the stars are very similar. It's just in the core that there's a difference. And so that difference is reflected in the buoyancy frequency shown here in black. Here is a red giant star. It looks like the star we looked at before. And here it's in the helium, core helium burning star. And what the difference between the models then is that in this case, the helium burning core is convective. And that means that here the buoyancy frequency is zero. And if we look at the equation for the period spacing, it's inversely proportional to this integral. And in the helium burning star, this integral is missing the central part. And so the integral is smaller, and therefore the period spacing is bigger. And that's exactly what Tim observed, and that shows that the that's the reason why we can distinguish between these two types of red giants. And that has also now been carried out for a large sample of stars by many people, including the group in Paris, Museerdal, showing this diagram where we have the large frequency separation on the horizontal axis corresponding essentially to the radius of the star, and the period spacing on the vertical axis. And here we see a distinction between the stars on the red giant branch down here with smaller period spacings and the helium burning stars in the red clump. And given that we can measure the mass, we can also distinguish between low mass helium burning stars and what we call the secondary clump in the more massive helium burning stars. And so we get a lot of information actually already here about the internal properties of these stars. And what you should remember, and which I think is stunning, and I never expected anything like that to come out from these observations, is that we are talking here about red giants, huge stars with radii 10 times the solar radius. And what we are distinguishing are the properties of a core, either inert here or helium burning here, a core that's not much bigger than the Earth. So we have this huge ball, and you can think of it as a huge styrofoam ball with a pebble in the inside. And what we are doing here is tell differences in the properties of that pebble from these observations of the oscillations in the star. So that's fantastic, but that's not all, because we can also observe how the star is rotating. And the way we do that is basically, not entirely, but one effect is at least that the waves we see on the surface of the star are running waves. So if this were to be animated, we would have the wave pattern rotating around the star. And if then we add stellar rotation to that wave pattern, the modes where the wave pattern is running in the same direction of the star has an increase in the frequency when we observe it. And the modes where the wave pattern is running in the opposite direction to the rotation of the star, the frequency is decreased. And so what we get is a splitting of the oscillation frequencies according to this azimuthal order of the wave, measuring the number of nodal lines across the equator. We get a splitting that measures an average of the internal rotation of the star. And that has been observed also in Kepler. And again, Paul Beck was the first to point this out in a paper in Nature, also in 2012. And you can take the same star that we looked at before, blow up the frequency spectrum, and see that there's a fine structure between the splitting of the dipolar, of the quadrupolar modes here, and the splitting of the dipolar modes. And observing this, these are the dipolar modes. We also see that in the quadrupolar modes. And for these dipolar modes, here we have the most acoustic modes. And then we have the splitting for these modes that have more of a gravity wave character, that have more of their inertia, their wave power in the interior, deep interior star. And what we see is that the splitting is larger for these waves than for the most acoustic waves. And so what is that is saying immediately is that the core of the star must be rotating more rapidly than the surface of the star, than the outer layers of the star. And from analysis of these observations, Paul Beck was able to show that the core of the star was rotating about 10 times faster than the surface of the star. This was a very early and approximate analysis, but it still gave an idea that the core of the star was rotating fast. And then again, you can do that for many stars and find that we have these stars' core rotation frequencies and finding that they are quite high for the radian stars. It's hard to put a meaning to a number like 1,000 nanohertz, 1 microhertz, but this shows that the core of the star is rotating about twice as fast as the sun. And then as we move to the red clump stars, we find that the cores of these stars are rotating much more slowly. And then again, you can ask, what do we expect from the models of these stars? And here we have to think a little bit about what happens to rotation as a star evolves. And very naively, if you look at rotating body that's changing its radius and conserving its angular momentum, if the radius decreases and the angular momentum is conserved, then the angular velocity has to increase roughly as the inverse square of the radius. And the same would apply to any part of the star if there's no angular momentum exchange within the star. And so looking again at this diagram and looking, for instance, at this part of the star with a radius, with a mass of 15% of the total mass of the star, we saw that shrank by about a factor of 10. And so you would expect that star, part of the star, to spin up by about a factor of 100 due to this contraction of the core. And looking at models of stars where calculating how fast a star would rotate as it evolves, moving up to this kind of red giant that we're looking at here. Of course, it would depend on the initial rotation rate of the star. If you start with a star that's rotating with a rotation speed of 50 kilometers per second on the zero age main sequence, which is quite reasonable, it would have a rotation frequency of the core of about 10 microhertz. If we start with a rotation frequency of a speed of 1 kilometer per second, the rotation speeds, it would rotate with a frequency of 400 microhertz. So spinning around once an hour, basically. If you start with 1 kilometer per second, you will still have a rotation frequency of 10 microhertz, and the observed value is only half a microhertz. So something has to transport the angular momentum from the core of the star towards the outer regions. And the issue we have is that there are various mechanisms proposed, turbulence, circulation, magnetic fields. You can always apply magnetic fields and try to do anything with that. Gravity waves. And all of these mechanisms fail to account for the rotation that we observe in these stars. So here's a summary showing again observed, in this case, rotation periods, where we have rotation periods of the order of a day or so observed. And then various models where some models with just standard hydrodynamical transport of angular momentum, where the rotation period is down to 1% of a day. Some magnetic models are able to get the rotation periods down to about 1 day, but actually none of the models produce rotation periods around the 10 days. And the surface rotation rate is in quite a lot longer because, of course, the outer layers of star have expanded. So we have here a problem that has still not quite been solved. There have been recent calculations that seem to show that certain versions of a magnetic mechanism might get the rotation periods up to look a bit more like the observed values, but this is still quite uncertain. And so this is one of the areas that still needs more work. And then, of course, we, having done that, we then have to explain why the rotation in the cores of the clump stars is so much slower than what we see in the red giants. So that is also very interesting. And if you'll allow me to go on for just a few minutes more, let me just talk about yet another thing that we are beginning to learn from these red giant stars. And that has to do perhaps with magnetic fields. And here we look at not the oscillation frequencies, but the oscillation amplitudes. And again, we're looking at a large group of stars, red giant branch stars in blue and red clump stars in red, and dipolar modes. And what we see is that for many of these stars, the amplitude doesn't change much as the star evolves. Remember that we have this frequency of maximum power, that's a measure of the rate of the star. So here we have stars closer to the main sequence at the base of the red giant branch, and then moving towards stars also in the red clump, but also stars higher up on the red giant branch. And for many of the stars, we have more or less the same kind of amplitude. These actually are amplitudes normalized with the radial mode amplitudes. But there is a group of stars here with very low amplitudes. And there, in fact, there are stars where we don't see the dipolar modes at all. And so the question is, what's going on here? And one clue to that was obtained by Dinistello in Sydney, where he split up the observed amplitudes according to stellar mass. So groups of stellar mass around 1.1 solar mass, 1.3, 1.5, 1.7, and 1.9 solar masses. And what he found was that for the 1.1 solar mass, we didn't really see any of these low amplitude modes. For 1.3, we begin to see a few. 1.5, we see quite a few. 1.7 solar masses, most of the modes of stars have low amplitude modes, and the same for the 1.9 solar mass stars. And so the question is, what distinguishes the structure of these stars? And the really quite striking insights that Dennis and also Jim Fuller in Caltech found, well, first of all, looking at the observations, I mean, if you look at the distribution of stars, all observed, we have most stars observed in fairly low mass. And here we have the most stars with normal amplitudes. And then we have these stars with suppressed amplitudes, and they tend to cluster for these higher masses that we saw here. And the remarkable insight was that these low mass stars, where we don't see suppression, have radiative cores on the main sequence. And we're talking about the red giants. But when they were young, these stars had radiative cores, and these higher mass stars, when they were on the main sequence, had convective cores. And this led to this model that Jim Fuller proposed, that if you have stars with convective cores on the main sequence, that convective core might generate a magnetic field in the core through dynamo action. And as the star evolves, well, convection of course stops in the core when the hydrogen burning stops, but the magnetic field might still be there. And as the core contracts, the field would then be compressed and the field intensity would increase. And so once we hit the convective, the radiant branch, we have a star with a huge convective envelope, and then a core where we have this magnetic field. And so what's happening to the dipole of most is that they have large amplitudes in the envelope. Then they penetrate into the core, and here they interact with the magnetic field in such a way as the waves are converted into alphine waves. They are scattered on the magnetic field. The alphine waves are damped. And so the modes lose energy through this magnetic interaction. And that then is what causes the lower amplitude that we observe for the dipolar modes on the surface of these stars. It doesn't happen in the low mass stars because it never had a convective core, so it doesn't have a magnetic field in the core. And it doesn't happen so much to modes of higher degree because the coupling between the envelope and the core is much weaker for these higher degree modes. And that then would be the reason why we observe these suppressed dipolar modes. Now that's a hypothesis which has to be, I mean, this is just a sketch, and this has to be demonstrated with more detailed calculations. And there have also been discussions about the observations. So I have to say that this at the moment is not a definite model of this suppression of the dipolar modes. But I think it's a very interesting indication that we might be learning about possible dynamo action in the core of these main sequence stars through these observations of radiants. So that's where we are. And that's where we are heading. Of course, it's clear that there is a lot we need to do with these data. We are very far from having explored all we can learn from the data. We hope to be able to learn more about the details of the convective cores in these stars, the course of these stars, learn more about the convective cores in the clump stars. And of course, we would like to have more data. And we are getting more data from the TESS mission, which was launched in 2018, run by your neighbors at MIT. It's producing a lot of data on red giants, unfortunately not observed for as long as Kepler. There are stars observed with TESS for 1 year near the ecliptic poles, and we are going to learn a lot from red giant observations from these stars. But the real, and some of us are working on that, extension of the test mission might actually be set up to observe a single field for longer than a year. And that would then be what might give us further data on these radiant stars. And so if you have a chance to influence the way the test mission is going to be operated, and it might last for the next few decades, you should certainly ask for observations of red giant stars for very long periods. But we're also going to get more data from the European Plato mission, scheduled for launch in 2026, and observing single fields at least for 2 years, and also producing data with a quality that's closer to what we have from Kepler. So I think there's a lot to look forward to here, and you can see that even though I'll stop getting salary for my work in a little more than a year, I certainly plan to continue working on this, and there's an awful lot of stuff that we can do on these stars for a long time, learning about what really happens inside these red giant stars. So with that, I'll stop and thank you for your attention on this very exciting day.
Thank you, Jørgen, and very fascinating stuff. Thank you very much. So let's open the floor for questions. Please use any mode of asking questions you choose. Now we'll monitor all the different ways. And while people are thinking about that, I want to ask you about my favorite topic with astroseismology, and you only touched upon it, which is improving the measurement of ages of stars. Where do we stand with that? Are you waiting for Plato data on this to improve them?
No, we're doing very well with Kepler data on main sequence stars. We have a fairly large sample of stars with quite well-determined ages, and what's quite interesting there is that we also have a sample of stars with known exoplanets, where we know the ages. And so we know that we have planets around stars with ages of up to 10, 11 gigayears. So there are planetary systems where a lot might have happened. We have 4 billion years more than we've had in the solar system for life to develop, if these stars have habitable planets, and for intelligent life to develop, grow up, and destroy itself, or turn into something else. So that's very fascinating. And of course, it's very fascinating to be able to study the properties of exoplanetary systems, depending on age. And that's where Plato is different, because for Plato, many more stars, main sequence stars, are going to be observed with astroseismology. And astroseismology is an integral part of the mission to characterize the exoplanet hosts. And that means that one of the things I'm doing these days is to write huge documents for ESA to document that we're going to be able to do that and set up the pipelines for doing that. So it's going to be great. It's a bit of work before we get that far. So we have ages, certainly, for these stars. For red giants, we don't have such direct measurements of the ages, because all the red giant, the structure of the red giant, the acoustic structure of the core of the red giants doesn't reflect the age in the same way as it does for the main sequence stars. But what we can determine for red giants are the masses. And the mass of a red giant is actually a pretty good measure of its age, because most of the life of that red giant has been spent on the main sequence. And so that means that if the mass is quite high, the star has to be fairly young. And if the mass is low, the age has to be quite large. And since we can determine masses and also radii for very, very many red giants, we have this very large sample of stars where we have a fairly decent determination of the age. And we can apply that when we do galactic archaeology, because it gives us a sample of stars in the galaxy where we know the location in the galaxy from Gaia. We know the and we know the age of the stars, and that gives us a very good samples of stars to probe the evolution of the galaxy. So that's also developing into a very interesting field of research, and that's something we can do also with the data from TESS, actually anywhere in the sky. And so for galactic archaeology, TESS is going to be an absolutely fantastic mission in terms of masses, radii, and ages of stars.
So we have a question from the chat by Sylvain. He says, his question is regarding the speed up of the core. So he is kind of remembering that this is reminiscent of the solar case. Remember the fast rotating solar core, when early on there were claims of fast rotating core. And so the question is, how do you feel about the observations of the red giants? Are the observations on solid ground, in your opinion?
Yes, I think there the observations are on very, very solid ground, because we are looking at a number of these mixed modes with dominant G-mode character. And there we definitely see that the rotational splitting is high. And we are able to model quite well how the splitting depends on the properties of the modes. And therefore we can really, with fairly high accuracy actually, I would say, determine the rotation of the core. What we don't have so much for red giants is a measure of the rotation of the outer layers, because it's quite hard to measure the rotational splitting of the acoustically dominated mode. So that's something where more work would be required. In a few cases, I think we have photometric determination of the rotation of the outer layers of the star. But the core rotation seems to be really on very solid grounds. And of course, the difference from the sun is that here we have modes that are predominantly in the core, whereas in the sun, we have to deal with acoustic modes, which only have, especially when it comes to rotation, a fairly small tail inside in the core. And therefore, it's much harder to determine the rotation of the core. People have been looking very, very hard for G modes in the sun, and so far I think the results that we have obtained are doubtful, but we are still working on it, and maybe we'll be lucky.
A follow-up on that is a question by Dave Latham about how well can you determine the orientation of the axis of rotation for the star?
Again, it depends on which stars we're looking at. For main sequence stars, we've done fairly well in several cases, simply by looking at the relative amplitudes of the different peaks in the power spectrum. And it's been done also in a few cases for red giants, actually. In the case I showed, I don't want to go back to the slides, but there what we would see if we saw all the modes for a dipolar mode would be three peaks. For L equals one, there are three values of m, -1, 0, and +1. And so we'd see those three peaks. But again, the geometry comes in. I mean, if you look at the sun, which we see almost equator on, then the m equal to zero modes have different sign of the oscillation on the two hemispheres. So there the oscillation will cancel in our observations. So there we only see the doublet, we see the m equal to zero, +1 and -1. And actually the red giant we looked at has the same structure. We see a doublet. And so we know that star we're looking at almost equator on. For other stars, we're able to see the triplets. Of course, if we see no rotation splitting, that actually means that we're looking at the star and the data are good enough that we ought to be able to see, we'll be looking at star polon. And if we see the triplet, then the relative amplitude of the components gives us a measure of the inclination angle. And that has been done in quite a few stars, main sequence stars. I don't think so, quite so many red giants, but I'm not up to speed on that. And again, of course, for the exoplanet hosts, it's very interesting because if we see a rotation axis that's inclined to the line of sight, and also see planets transiting that star, then we know that the planets are not orbiting in the equatorial plane of the star. And so since we would assume that the stars were formed in the equatorial plane, with a disk from which the star planets were formed, was then something must have happened to the rotational star or to the orbital planets. And that, of course, is very interesting from the point of view of exoplanets, planetary system evolution. I really need to go in and look at what is known about the inclination of the red giant's rotation axis. It's not something that's been discussed a lot, but there must be more data on that.
Thank you. Would you expect that some of the scatter or broadening on those diagrams is due to that, or most of it is simply mass differences?
I would think that much of it is mass differences, yes.
Yeah.
Of course, there might be cases where one has misidentified the splitting if the amplitudes, if not sequence noise level is not quite good enough. But there would be a mass sensitivity. There could also be a sensitivity to the internal rotation rates. There could be a sensitivity to the efficiency of the transport mechanism, whatever that is. So that's just something else we need to look at. But I might mention, I didn't talk about that, but we also have subgiants and stars on the way to becoming red giants, where we have measured internal rotation rates that are sort of intermediate between the what we see on the main sequence and what we see on a red giant branch. We don't have, for main sequence stars, we don't have much information about the internal rotation. We have some indications the stars seem to be rotating more or less solar-like, that the internal rotation rate is not much faster than what we see on the surface. But in these subgiants, we begin to see that the core is rotating more rapidly than the surface. And so we have sort of the start of an evolutionary history by combining these data of the rate of rotation from the main sequence. Of course, the sun, we know the rotation very well, and then up to the red giant branch.
That's great. Well, Jørgen, this was a fantastic update on a fantastic subject, and it was a great talk. Thank you very much for coming in virtually into CFA. Hope to see you in person very soon.
Absolutely.
And many thanks again from all of us for a great talk.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.